You're a movie guy. What would you say you do here?
Wow. What would I say I do here? Cause a lot of mischief is what I really do. It's yeah, it's well, one of my favorite movies of all time was Broadcast News, so I would minus hopefully the flop sweats that Albert Brooks had in the movie. I would relate to that, and probably when I first saw it, I would say that.
Which character?
Oh, that's a very good question. I'm not quite sure. I think many times the William Hurt character, when I have someone in my ear telling me what to say next. No, just kidding. But I
The
think you.
phony is what you're saying.
Yeah, right. No, I just thought that whole thing resonated at that time. I thought that movie was depicted a lot of what television news was about. So I'd probably pick Broadcast News is what I do here.
From 8 in the morning till 10:30 at night, you're basically on, not continuously, but
Right.
your day starts at 8 and it goes till 10:30 talking about sports. What is that like, and how do you handle that
Well,
schedule?
I've wondered myself as well. It's a different medium. I mean, radio is a totally different animal, and I think, especially morning radio. People said, "Why couldn't you just do it from home?" Well, it's not the same. You interact with the guys in the Power Trip, with Corey Cove and Paul Lambert and Chris Hockey and the gang and the extras that are there, and it's a personal thing, and I think it just feels like I've been able to really communicate with people in a much longer format. I've been doing radio a long time, and I think certainly that show has hit its niche, and it's really fun to be a part of it. But yeah, it's tiring. You turn the page and you go home for a couple hours and try to recalibrate what your day is going to be like. Try to get a couple errands done, whatever it might be. Maybe take a quick nap once in a while. And then back to KFAN again in the afternoon with the common man most days. And then, oh, by the way, then there's my other job here at Channel 4. And you come in at, after 3, and it gets kind of hectic for the rest of the day. Yeah, by Thursday night, my last day of the week, I was pretty wiped out. So I questioned it many times myself, but I couldn't stop the train at this point. So I was pretty much just going along with it and doing the best I could.
You seem to really enjoy doing the morning show there at KFAN. What
Well,
is it about that you really love?
I think I love doing the morning show because there's a generational gap between all of us. We all have different takes on things, and I think with their humor and their way of looking at the world, I try to add some maturity, if that's the right word. But honestly, I just like going along with it because they you're open game. You're open for everybody. I mean, really. I mean, your life's an open book, and I think I don't mind being the brunt of the jokes. I've walked down the street and people have yelled things at me that I've said on that show in the morning, and I think people relate to it. In this day and age, I think with the way people are, it's so impersonal with the way we communicate with each other, with texting and Facebook and everything else, that I think actually, people going to work or whatever they're doing, listening to voices and people they get to know, it's relatable. It's like, hey, someone's having a conversation with me, and it's personal, a little more personal, and they can relate to it. I feel like that way when I'm listening to it myself, where we're talking about movies or sports. We do talk sports, other topics that could float through the air in the morning and our sound bites. And it's like conducting an orchestra. I think Corey Cove does a really good job of conducting it, and Chris Hockey. And you just have to kind of know your place and when to talk, when to keep your mouth shut, when to interject. And and you have to have the realization that you're going to say something, and guess what? It's like a good friend. You're going to get hit for it if you're not, doesn't make sense. So I just enjoy the camaraderie. They're some of my best friends right now. I really enjoy being with them, and being the old elder statesman, I think that they've accepted that part of the credibility issue that I can bring to them as well at times. And the storytelling. I mean, I do have a different perspective. I have more years. When they talk about shows, from the 70s, or I say, "Have you ever seen the movie The Godfather?" And they just look at you blankly. I'm going, "You may want to catch it." I mean, or anything, God forbid, it was in black and white. They sometimes I have to educate them on some of the finer things in life that they may have missed because they were buried in their Nintendo.
KQ was your first radio
1986, I started
1986.
KQRS.
And that was not going to be what it eventually turned into, right?
I started at KQ. My son was born in December of 1985, and I was asked to go on and do little three-minute radio updates. I put a line, as they say, in my kitchen, in my townhouse. And I knew my life was going to change, but I thought, wow, I never got up that early before.
Why did you want to do that to begin with?
Was I don't know. I don't know. I think
you're at work till late at night.
Yeah,
you thought let's do the morning show.
It was fun just to do some different things on the radio, and so they just put a line in. I put my headsets on. I was doing little 3-minute updates, and figured then I could just, you know, my little boy was at home, and that was something to do. And then in April of '86, Tom Bernard started over there, and then it turned into a free for all. A 3-minute update turned into a half hour, and the station just blew up. Our show blew up. It was amazing. We hit it off, and the rest is history. I ran for governor, and I mean, it was nuts. The Twins won the World Series the following year, and we were like the station of this Twin Cities. We were the pulse of the Twin Cities because of the Twins players and the environment and what that station did. It was really an extraordinary time.
Does it remind you of kind of the situation you have with KFAN now, or is it a different dynamic?
No, it in many ways it does. I mean, I think just we caught a team over there as well, and I think all these years later, there are similarities between the way that people relate to our morning show. And we've done those shows at the State Fair. They do one show a year when the power trip goes out there, and it's packed. I mean, it's as far as the eye can see, and It took a long time, and it doesn't happen by accident. I mean, you know, I give credit to the management people over there. They kind of figured out what works, and you know, it's, especially when you've got an ensemble cast, and there's no script to say that those guys meet, they put their heads together, they do a nice job, and I'm just excited to be a part of it because, you know, I offer what I can, and I know when to stay in my lane. I don't try to be an expert on things that I have known nothing about. When they start talking about certain music and things, I'm going, hey, listen, guys, I haven't heard that. I'd rather talk about Earth, Wind, and Fire and some old R&B, whatever it might be. So go ahead and listen to your techno music.
Does radio scratch a different itch for you than TV?
Yeah, radio's always, I think, allowed me to take a breath and really kind of just expand on who I am. People got to know me starting with KQ and then obviously to where we are today by radio, because, you know, TV doesn't really, you don't have that much time, the nightly sportscast, to show that side of your personality. Certainly I had opportunities, plenty of opportunities during Sports Sunday for many years, but when you have, you know, a couple hours or whatever it is, an hour, and you're talking about a variety of subjects, I mean, it's freewheeling, and there's no hiding behind anything. I mean, you just be yourself. I mean, there's a role you play on the show. I mean, I think with Common Man in particular, you know, he gets me going and he pushes my buttons, and that's real when I get mad at him. But at the same time, you know, we know, and he knows, it's showbiz. I mean, it's sort of like, you know, wrestling. I mean, you just have to push some buttons and have a lot of fun. But yeah, I mean, it's enabled me to kind of really expand on things and not have to worry about, you know, some producer in my ear telling me you got 5 seconds to wrap things up. You know, I got a lot more time than that.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned radio and the connection.
Yep.
Why do you think you connected so well with viewers? Why do you think you resonated with them the way you did? Do you think it was simply just that you were on the radio when others weren't, or is it the longevity?
There was a period of time when I'm sure I wasn't resonating with viewers. I mean, there were times early in my career, and even when I started doing weekends and everything, where I probably was pretty much flatlining with viewers. I don't think I was doing anything special. Longevity does help, but you have to be relevant, and I think you have to be. I think radio helped propel me with KQ, and certainly kickstarted a lot of different things. People looked at me a little differently, where I was just, you know, a sports guy, you know, covering, you know, Vikings, Twins, you know, North Stars at the time, whatever it might be. And now it's like, oh, that's a different side of him. I didn't know that about him. And I think the key thing is just being myself. I mean, it takes time to be comfortable in your own skin and to be comfortable to burst out of that bubble that you're in broadcasting, where you try sometimes too hard to kind of stay inside of yourself. And I realized there's no sense of doing that. You have to blow it up a little bit and yet stay true to yourself, because when people try to be something else other than what they are, especially in this market, I think you get slammed down. I've seen it a couple times when other stations brought sportscasters in here, and wow, I mean, it was like, what, this is not going to work here. And you can tell right away, mm-hmm. this is not going to fly here.
Let's talk about your TV job here. Do you have a certain approach or a methodology to what you do here on a daily basis? You know,
I've always enjoyed the process as much as delivering the sports.
There is a whole 8-hour day before those 3 minutes.
I get a kick out of the fact that you're only work 3 minutes a day. I went, yeah, right, okay. I think the process has always intrigued me. I was taught early on by my mentors to tell a story. I mean, to find a way of communicating with people in your own voice, in your own words, but do it in a way that's interesting, that gets them gets them into the tent, so to speak. And it's not shock value. I think it's just being realistic. And so I've always enjoyed, and still enjoy to this day, the process of sitting down and having that opportunity. Look at the freedom we have in sports in particular is that, we don't have to have our scripts okayed by anyone. If I want to express an opinion about what the Vikings are doing or the Wild, whatever it might be, do it. And I think, we know that our credibility is on the line, or my credibility is on the line when you say it, but I think you don't have to slam people, but there's a way of delivering it, I think, to add information that people don't have, or perspective that you have, whether we're talking about, as I've mentioned a couple of times, why Mike Zimmer fired DeFilippo. I'm going, well, why did he? I don't think he should have done it. I thought it was a knee-jerk reaction. People can agree or disagree, that's fine, it's sports. But I think we have the advantage of being able to burst out of that bubble a little bit, because we don't have to play it straight as the newscasters do. Mm-hmm. They have to deliver the news. This is the way it is. They can't. There's no editorializing in the copy. We can write what I want to say, how I want to say it. So to me, the process has always been the most important thing, and what I still get a kick out of it, because you can write any game story I could do it at 3 o'clock in the morning in my sleep. But if you want to add something, to added information, so people
perspective.
People who haven't seen the game, they'll know that there's something extra that happened, that you're giving them a little bit extra information, and with your own personality.
So when you sit down to write your scripts for the mm-hmm. 6 o'clock or the 10 o'clock show, does it kind of just flow out of you, or do you have to sit there and think for a while about what you want to say?
It kind of flows out of me by now. It just does. There are times when I kind of surprise myself sometimes, really, like, what am I going to say? Well, I'll just start typing. And there are times I'm like, I hit the delete button, delete, 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 and find a different way of saying it, and you look at it, and I try to read my copy. I was taught that early on by my mentors to read your copy over before you go on the air. I mean, don't just rely on the teleprompter. Don't rely on, read it over and emphasize certain words. I used to underline certain words sometimes I want to hit that word a little harder. You can still do that, even though you're electronically typing things up. I think it sort of does. I think there's a tendency kind of sometimes to overwrite things with highlights, and realizing you can just do, as we're many times we're in the field and doing live shots, you don't have a script. For many, many times, I feel like I could just do the sportscast without a script. And I would have been fine with that, but you obviously have technical things that you're dealing with that mm-hmm. need to be done. But I just think that it's become more and more comfortable, but I'm challenged by it all the time. I was always challenged by getting better at it, writing a better script, being more succinct, adding a little more personality. Not necessarily being cutesy or trying to find that laugh line, but just, because you can't hear how people are reacting when you're sitting in the studio. Whether it's like delivering a joke and somebody goes, was that funny? I don't know.
Sometimes we can hear Amelia laughing.
Yeah, Amelia will laugh once in a while. They get her going. And I'll just stare at her during some video. I'll say something about, another Minnesota team choked again tonight or something. When I look at her, she'll just roll her eyes at me. But yeah, it's that's the part I will miss, is that part of writing. The writing part has always been my favorite.
What do you think would be the biggest thing people would be surprised to know about your typical day?
How boring it is. How monotonous it is. I mean, I think people think that we go to all these sporting events and you get, you know, best seat in the house, pardon my plug for my book. But, you know, I mean, it's pretty monotonous. I mean, in terms of when you come here during the day, do our 6 o'clock, and then a lot of people just sort of scatter, and it's pretty much myself and my dinner, wherever I happen to be eating that night here, and watching fill in the blank, Twins game, Wild game. Oh, you get to watch a game. Yeah, but you're not watching it as a fan. You're watching it as someone who's going to be reporting on it. And so it's you're watching and watching and watching, and then you're also writing the rest of the sportscast. You're trying to, you know, put some perspective on other things. And so I think it's, yeah, I think people would find it that it's not as exciting and glamorous as made out to be. Most of the time, it was just pretty, kind of lonely. I mean, it was kind of just you and your thoughts and giving Jed on the desk, you know, some good-natured grief and
he deserves it. Our Simon editor.
It's that camaraderie, you know, that I still like in the newsroom, that I'm always more, you know, poking and prodding a little bit. And I think you need to have that. And certainly, having gone through everything that I've gone through, I don't mind being the guy that's doing the poking, because I think it keeps people alive and you have a lot of fun and it establishes those relationships, which is very important. But yeah, I think the monotony of it is something people find surprisingly.
You have a method that I've observed in my years working over you. Whether you're at a Vikings game at mm-hmm. U.S. Bank Stadium or the Metrodome right. before that, or like you said, you're sitting at your desk mm-hmm. watching a game on TV, if it's a road game or right. a Wild game or whatever else, you chart every play. How long have you done that, and why is that what you do?
I chart every play of the Vikings games all the time. Because
just so people understand, every play, you write down what happens. Every
long
play.
Game.
Yeah.
Yes. I found it easier long before computers to be able to, I write down time of day, I write down the down and distance, and what happened, and if it was a big play, or a bad play, or just a meaningful play, I'd put a star, or 2 stars on it. So I would know when I got back that I would be able to find that a lot quicker than just relying on the Vikings notes or whatever it would be my notes. I would be memorable for me. I would remember what I wrote down. So I started that years and years ago and continued doing it till the last game I covered here last Sunday, you know, the last week against the mm-hmm. Bears. You know, with basketball, you know, I don't write down every play, but if it gets interesting at the end, I do, and then I'll, you know, like same type of thing, because you can look, if you don't see the game, you can look at a stat sheet or look on your computer to see that Carl Anthony Towns made this basket, but it doesn't tell you what set it up. I mean, if you saw it, visually see it, this is what I'm saying, where you have to watch it. It was a great pass, it was a great steal. You're not going to see that. Same thing with the Viking game. Mm-hmm. You know, more importantly with the Viking game, because you just have the information. You don't have what set it up or how a guy busted a tackle or how he missed on something. So I just found it more comfortable to always have my own notes.
Do you save them? Or do you throw them out when the book gets
No, started? I threw them out. Okay. I saved a couple.
So there's no 50-year log of Vikings games.
Oh, my God, I hope not. No 50-year log. But I do remember when I first started out, my job was to be up in the old tape room. We recorded the games on, I believe it was 2-inch videotape. And that's when I started it, because I would chart the games upstairs. And my job would be to write the script for someone else. And we would write 3-minute highlight packages. So I would write down all the plays, work with the tape editor, the engineer upstairs, to edit those upstairs. And so I think that's where that whole practice started. It was just an old school way of doing things, and it worked for me. So I know I'm the only person that probably still does it. Other people probably think, what is he doing? Why don't you just take the notes the Vikings give you? Because I just don't feel comfortable mm-hmm. with that. Mm-hmm. You know, I like seeing my own scribbling so I can kind of make heads or tails of it.
After you leave here, you'll still have radio. The K-Fan thing will continue. How important is it to you to still have that connection with the people who enjoy watching or listening to you, that they'll still have a way to you know, be a part of your life, and you'll still be able to have a part of theirs.
I've kind of bristled a couple times when people go, congratulations on your retirement, and wish you the best in your retirement. That word just kind of, I get it. I mean, I am leaving here after close to 50 years, but I'm not retiring. I'm just slowing the gears down a little bit.
And finally.
Yeah. And at the same time, I'm definitely ready for some new challenges. And I think radio will definitely present a lot of that. I mean, I'm still going to be very active in the sports scene, so I'm not going anywhere. In fact, I hope to do more things. And I'll have an opportunity to do a podcast and to do a lot of different things besides sports. I fortunately have developed a lot of contacts over the years, and whether it's the entertainment business, which is a big interest of mine, authors, whatever it might be, I plan on doing a lot of different things on a podcast where, again, there's no time limitations, basically. And I think people are finding ways to personalize that, and I know there's an audience out there, and I think that's kind of the wave of the future. So I'm anxious to do that. I'm anxious to do some writing for the website. Probably go to more news conferences than I go now because I just haven't had the time. But also just be home at night. I mean, I've never, ever had any consistency with that. I've never been home at night my entire adult life, other than, obviously my Friday and Saturday nights. But I mean, in terms of, I don't know what it's like to go to a movie on a Tuesday night. I wouldn't know what it's like to go listen to some music on a local artist that I like. And I hear friends talk about all the time. Hey, I'm going to see so-and-so at the Dakota.
Okay. Have fun.
I mean, all that works out.
Wave to me as
you walk
by the station.
So, I mean, I think it's the timing is right, and obviously there's some personal reasons as well, which is the number one thing I'm dealing with right now with the health of my wife, and I think that all those things feel like I know this is the right time. I knew from, as my sage, one of my first mentors, Bud Grant, said, never make a decision before you have to. And I mean, I always kind of lived by that. Well, this is the time to make that decision, and I don't regret it at all.